chair, particularly Kajit Kumar Singh, who was associated with me in Kanpur as a PhD student at that time. He also was a PhD student with us. We worked on heat and mass transfer on porous media. Of course, my first exposure to coal technology also was because of Ajay. I visited Dharia mines, went inside and saw how a coal mine looks like. I had no idea before that. And after that, I shifted to IIT Madras, and about 10 years back, there was a student from Kerala who wanted to work on coal gasification, particularly Indian coal. And we set up a 20 kilowatt in-train flow gasifier. And later on, we were also involved in a European FP7 project, again looking at gasification of Indian coal. Of course, there are many, it's a consortium kind of thing, but many other partners were there from India, IIT Madras, and Thermax. We were involved in this project. Still, looking at so many salvats who are looking at coal technology, I feel as if I'm carrying coal to Manchester, as the saying goes. Of course, in academic circles, we don't look at large-scale projects, but smaller ones. And our main interest has been to understand what is coal gasification, what are the parameters that influence gas gasification, coal gasification, etc. So in this, we have done modeling as well as some lab-scale experimentation. And of course, one main reason why gasification is important is that Indian coal particularly has a lot of ash. And wherever any steel plant or whatever, you're carrying so much of ash, almost 40-50% of weight. And that is finally, it's a nuisance in every sense. And so if we can remove it right at the mine itself and get the gas out, and preferably set up the power plant also nearby, transportation of gas is much easier. And even things like if you have to, because Indian coal does not have much sulfur, but in case there is some sulfur that could be removed, sulfur dioxide could be removed and so on. So you can clean and then directly send it for power generation in a plant. And the gasification itself, again, the syngas that we get, depending on our interest, whether it has to go for some low, let us say thermal application, home heating, etc., then the calorific value can be low. In that case, we just simply gasify with less amount of air than what is needed for combustion. Or if you want some medium calorific value kind of fuel which can be used in power plants, etc., in that case, preferably either with oxygen or at least oxygen-enriched air that can be used. And also, you arrange the conditions such that, with steam also, so that you get a mixture of hydrogen and carbon monoxide, maybe a small amount of methane as well in the gas. That can provide a medium calorific value gas. And if you really want synthetic natural gas, you know, that is possible. But in that case, it has to be a catalytic conversion. And you can produce more amount of methane and less amount of carbon monoxide. And so depending upon the application, it is possible to have low calorific value, medium calorific value, high calorific value. And under what conditions these are preferred and so on, that depends upon the pressure, temperature, and so many other things. And the different reactions which are there, partial oxidation reactions, let's say carbon burning to produce carbon dioxide, a carbon partially burning to produce carbon monoxide. These are exothermic, so they produce the heat necessary for the other reactions. And the coal gasification itself involves many heterogeneous and homogeneous reactions. Heterogeneous means the phases involved, I mean you don't have just one single phase, there could be a solid and gas. And usually these heterogeneous reactions are very slow because gaseous reactions are very fast, gaseous molecules move very fast. So in general, gaseous reactions may take place even in few milliseconds possibly. But the heterogeneous reactions, particularly for example in this, we have this so-called Boudot reaction, which involves carbon plus carbon dioxide give rise to CO. This is a very slow reaction because it involves the char. Similarly, any reaction with char and water vapor, char and CO2, etc., these are very slow. On the other hand, anything which involves gaseous phase reactions will be generally faster. And again, in gasification particularly, some of the reactions are endothermic, they require the heat, and some are exothermic, they provide the heat. And these reactions, as I said, the rates are very different. In fact, in our European partners, they were doing biomass gasification also, so-called Milena process which is developed in Europe. There, definitely they want amount of many of these solid fuels, coal or biomass, a good amount of volatile matter will be there, and then fixed carbon char will be there. The char reactions are very slow, whereas the volatiles will come out very quickly. Even at 400, 500 degrees, volatiles will evolve, and they will participate in combustion and so on. So some gasification reactions, you take the volatiles separately, and then for the char gasification, you do it separately, maybe. So that's, in fact, the Milena process that I mentioned, they do something like that. So a fluidized bed reactor for the char gasification, and simply an entrain bed kind of fast reactor for the evolution of volatiles and so on. So we need to understand these things a little more deeply, which reactions are fast, which reactions are slow, and what conditions are needed, which are preferred at high pressure, which are preferred at low pressure, and so on. What is the effect of particle size on these reactions? These are some of the things which are essential. And as I said earlier, as academicians, we don't look at all these billions of or trillions of gas, etc. We rather look at some 20 kilowatt, 100 kilowatt, or some smaller thing. But the interest is mainly to see what is the effect of different parameters. So this on this lecture, particularly, we'll talk about the mathematical modeling of some of these and how different parameters will influence. Many of the reactions that are involved are reversible. They go both in the forward as well as reverse direction. And equilibrium constants, they can be calculated based on free energy. In fact, equilibrium in any chemical system will depend upon the minimum free energy. So once the system reaches the minimum free energy, it will reach an equilibrium situation. And the products will freeze, basically. Of course, what will be the composition of those equilibrium products will depend on the pressure, temperature, and so on, and even initial composition and things like that. So many of the reactions, for example, carbon, oxygen, producing CO or CO2, all of these are reversible, actually. And especially what is given here is the log to the 10 of the equilibrium constant. What this means is that if this constant has a very large value, the forward reaction will proceed. Whenever it gives a 10 power, for example, let's say 25 or something, it's a huge value. That means the forward reaction will be CO2 will be produced at these conditions. As you go to higher and higher temperatures, of course, the dissociation also will start happening. Similarly, for example, if you look at the methanation reaction involving carbon and hydrogen producing CH4, interestingly, it has a different kind of behavior that at high temperatures, the equilibrium constant will be very low. That means at high temperatures, the formation of methane is not preferred. Methane will rather break up. At lower temperatures, obviously, formation of methane is preferred. But unfortunately, if you go to very low temperatures, the equilibrium constant only gives you when equilibrium is reached. It may be infinite time. When it is reached, the composition will have more of methane and less of this thing. But the rate at which it will happen will depend on temperature. And if you really go to very low temperatures, the reaction will be so slow, you really have to wait for infinite number of years for that to happen. But some finite temperature like 700, 800 degrees, it is possible to have good amount of methanation reaction happening. But then even then, to hasten up the reaction and so on, catalyst may be needed. So some nickel-based catalysts and so on can be used. So what it implies is that the some idea about effect of pressure, temperature, etc. can be obtained by looking at the equilibrium constant, which is based on free energy of the reaction. But in practice, if you really want to achieve that in a reasonable amount of time, then we need to have sufficiently high temperature and maybe pressure as well. The same thing plotted in terms of, in a graphical form. In fact, even the effect of pressure and temperature, some kind of the graphs are available also in literature. And you will see that, for example, the percentage of carbon monoxide is preferred at lower temperatures, actually, at higher temperatures. So the higher the temperature, you get more carbon monoxide. But pressure itself is relatively, if it is lower, it is preferred. But then, as I said, the equilibrium composition is not the only thing that we should look at. We should also look at the rate at which it is happening. So from rate considerations, usually you may go for maybe 10 bar, 15 bar, some kind of moderate pressure. But temperatures generally are higher temperatures preferable for the formation of methane. Similarly, carbon monoxide and hydrogen, very similar kind of a thing, that at higher temperatures, moderate pressures is preferable. Methane, on the other hand, formation of methane is preferable at higher pressure and lower temperature. But as I said, if the temperature is very low, then the rate of the reaction will be so slow that practically it will be useless. You have to wait for infinite time for the formation of methane. So to hasten it, obviously, you will have some catalyst there. So depending upon what is the syngas composition that we want, whether you want more methane in it, more carbon monoxide, more hydrogen, etc. Depending on the calorific value, etc., it is possible to shift. I mean, all these things are possible in reactors, on it, but in whole gasification underneath, how to do that is a totally different ball. But all said and done, still, this gives some idea about what are the conditions that need to be maintained. And there are different type of industrial gasifiers. And as you see here, fixed bed, fluid end bed, entrain flow, etc. Temperature-wise, they're generally in the range of about 100,000 degrees Celsius, and pressures also maybe 30, 40, etc. And gasifying medium can be different, can be air, can be oxygen, or air infused with oxygen, air and oxygen and steam, etc. Again, depending upon what is the kind of syngas that you want, whether you want a slightly higher calorific syngas or lower calorific syngas, etc. Usage of oxygen has other advantages as well. One thing is that since nitrogen is not there, the gas that comes out will have a higher calorific value. And another thing is, it will basically consist of, let us say, if you send it for a power plant, after burning, there will be only carbon dioxide and water vapor. Water vapor can be condensed and CO2 can be sequestrated. So from sequestration point of view also, the use of pure oxygen is helpful, but of course it is costly, you have to separate oxygen and those kind of issues are there. But preferably if you want higher calorific value, then use of oxygen plus steam could be very helpful. Particularly since nitrogen is not there, the calorific value will be quite high. And another thing that I want to point out is that particle size, depending on the type of gasifier, fixed bed gasifiers will have large particle size, and fluid end bed about 10 mm, 5 mm, etc. Entrain flow, it has been micron, 100 micron, 200 micron, so that the particles will be carried. The underground coal gasification, to some extent, can be taken similar to a fixed bed, that the particles are not moving, it's only the gas which is moving. So some of the considerations that are used for a fixed bed, like a low-key gasifier, etc., some of those things can even be applied for modeling the underground coal gasification. And residence time, typically like ours. Whereas in a fluid end bed, the particle will remain only for, let's say, 5-10 minutes. Entrain flow is like seconds. So a smaller particle size, smaller residence time in the entrain flow gasifier. Fluid end bed, moderate positive particle size, moderate residence time. Fixed bed will be obviously much more, residence time as well as particle size will be much larger. The underground coal gasification can be somewhat considered like a fixed bed gasifier. But again, the process are much more complex. But at least some of the issues can be considered to be similar. And for example, this is a Lurgi fixed bed gasifier where grate is moving. Now this grate, big lumps of coal will be there, and the gas, the medium will be passing through this, and either air or air plus steam or oxygen plus steam or whatever. And of course in the gasifier equipment in general, removal of tar is an important consideration, but that may not be a problem in UCG. But in gasifiers, if it is not removed, this tar may go and settle down at all kinds of places and create problem in course of time. We have already mentioned about these. The underground coal gasification itself, as many speakers have spoken, obviously one through which the media are sent and other through which the syngas is coming out. And preferably the power plant itself could be located near the where the syngas is coming so that power can be produced then and there. Looking at the fundamental processes of coal itself, coal, if you look at the you can do ultimate analysis and proximate analysis. In proximate analysis, the volatiles, the moisture volatiles, then finally breaking up into ash, etc. So the as you heat it somewhere in the range of 400, 500 degrees, the volatiles will come out and they combust. And then the heat that is produced through this will be useful for the other reactions. And then the char, which is after the emission of the volatiles, the char which is left, char plus ions will be there, of course. The char reactions in general are very slow, whether it is with oxygen or with water vapor or any other thing. So those slow reactions, we have to find a way. If smaller the particle, obviously faster will be the process. So in general, even if the coal that we are gasifying is in the form of lump, we have to find a way to break it up into small particles, preferably even smaller than a millimeter, if possible. If it is very, very small, of course, it will be taken away by the gas. So the overall reaction can be hastened up. And one of the main things that will happen in gasification as well as in combustion reactions, that the oxygen has to diffuse through the medium. Often, when the surface layer is burnt out, ash will be there. Of course, it will be a porous kind of thing. Through the porous medium, the oxygen or whatever other reaction that is taking place, those gases have to penetrate through. So this Knudsen diffusion will be there in the process, and that is something that has to be taken into account. But the ash layer also will be breaking up from time to time. So those processes, even at the level of a single coal particle, they are fairly complex. And the ash which is present is not a silent partner. It is actually, many times there is evidence to show that the ash itself does act like a catalyst in some situations for certain type of processes. And as I mentioned, our first experience with gasification was setting up a kind of tubular gasifier. This is for a capacity of about 20 kilowatt, and we did both modeling as well as experimental work on this. And so first thing in our model, of course the model that we had using, let's say, some of the standard software which are available. So we did what's called Eulerian Lagrangian formulation. There is Eulerian formulation to model the gas phase, the Lagrangian formulation to track the particles which are there. And you can actually consider the heat and mass transfer, the flow aspects, etc., between the particles and the gas. And so first thing that we did was to validate our model with, let's say, the Australian core and Japanese core, and predictions versus what was seen, reported in the paper. We were able to get fairly good, almost on all parameters, right from the composition of carbon monoxide, hydrogen, carbon dioxide, etc., the carbon conversion percentage, the high heating value of the fuel, and the coal gas efficiency. On all of this, the predictions were in reasonable agreement with what was there in the theory, the experiment. And then our own experimental methodology, we looked at various parameters, of course, right from composition to many other things. And the Indian goals that we took, the compositions are given here. So both the approximate analysis as well as the ultimate analysis, both are given here. And main thing is, of course, the ash percentage. See, the Australian Japanese coal, ash percentage is less than 10% or so. But any Indian coal you look at, 30, 35, 40, sometimes even 50. So huge amount of ash is present. And that, in fact, renders the calorific value of the coal itself to be low. So the even gasification process, everywhere you have to take into account the fact that all the media have to penetrate through the ash in order to for the reaction to take place. Particularly on the heterogeneous reactions involving solid with gas, etc., will be slowed down quite a bit if the medium has to penetrate through the ashes. And this is, of course, experimental thing to see TJ analysis or thermodynamic analysis was done. Initial loss of heat is because of moisture. Then later on, this is because of the volatiles which are there. And then the later on, the char and so on. And partly, you will also have reactions occurring, some vaporization and so on. So different goals, their characteristics were looked at. And even by crushing them to a different level, so these particle size could be also varied, 60 micron, 90 micron, 150 micron, etc. We wanted to understand the effect of the size of the particle on the process and things like that. So this is just a schematic of the experimental setup. The actual setup is shown there. So where you first light up with LPG, so you light it up, and then, in fact, what we found is that for this reactor to start functioning reasonably well, the temperature had to be brought somewhere in the range of 900,000 degrees. Until then, it was not gasifying properly. So to produce that temperature, in the beginning, we in fact used an LPG burner and heated up the gasifier to a fairly high temperature. Once the tube gets heated up to 900,000 degrees, then there was absolutely no problem. So anything, depending on how much air is sent, how much steam is sent, and so on, we were able to do the gasification fairly good. And the particles were crushed to something like 60 micron or 90 micron because it's an entrain flow gasifier that we studied first. Yeah, and the numerical methodology is mentioned here. So because of the, this like a tube, so we solved the axisymmetric equations of mass, momentum, energy balance, and so on. The gas phase equations already in frame, that means like a control volume kind of approach. Whereas for the cold particles, we have to track the particles in Lagrangian frame. So if as each particle is moving, so the change in mass, temperature, and so on, they have to be, they are coupled. The particle phase and the gas phase are coupled. So whatever mass loss from the particle phase, it will appear in the gas phase and so on. So we need to look at mass, momentum, energy, species balance, and things like that. So these are solved together. And additional things, in any gasifier or any other kind of device, when we deal with particles or droplets and so on, they are not of uniform size. There will be a distribution of particle sizes. So that is taken care in the form of a Rosen-Tromler distribution, which is a common distribution for droplets as well as typically cold particles, etc. So this is a, so the characterizing the pole itself, we need to get the mean diameter as well as the parameter n, which characterizes the distribution. So the species considered in the model are carbon solid, oxygen, nitrogen, carbon monoxide, hydrogen, CO2, H2O, etc., and some form of the volatile. And any reaction in general will be, let us say, the kinetic rates are given by a typical Arrhenius form, where there may be an explicit dependence on temperature. This basically comes from molecular speeds, etc. And then with the activation energy, you have the Arrhenius factor. So the kinetic rate coefficient will be like this. And then, depending on the type of, let's say, the pressure will play a role, and diffusion will play a role, and so on. So the diffusivity, diffusion rate constant, itself is a function of temperature and so on. So we need to really, for any surface reaction, these kind of parameters have to be looked at in detail. The charge consumption is by C plus half O2 gives CO, then carbon plus water vapor gives CO plus H2. This is the Godard reaction, C plus CO2 gives 2CO, etc. So in modeling all these reactions, again from literature, we need to take the kinetic constants, the order of the reaction, etc. And in Indian coal, because of the high level of ash, so the because of the high ash level, we need to consider the enhancement in reactivity due to mineral matter. I was mentioning that ash does play the role of a catalyst in some sense. So the reactivity can be enhanced by the mineral matter. But reactivity will decrease because of the low diffusivity. It is a porous layer. Through that, oxygen has to diffuse, etc. So that will result in decrease of reactivity, and of course radiation heat transfer and so on. These kind of things have to be taken into account. So some of this rate constants, we have to take into account the fact that there will be some effect of ash. There will be obviously an effect of the ash porosity and so on. So there are some literature, some papers available. We have taken from different sources. And the homogeneous reactions that are taking place in the gas phase, there are many of them. To produce either carbon dioxide or carbon monoxide and so on. So all these reactions have to be dealt with simultaneously. As far as the homogeneous reactions are concerned, they are like any gaseous reactions. So most of the reactions are second order. Rarely they may be different from second order. So we need to consider the kinetic steps involved in detail and simultaneously solve. And so some of the parameters that have been given, the air ratio, steam ratio and so on, these are input parameters. And carbon conversion, coal gas efficiency, heating value, etc. are output parameters. Of course, the percent gas, we have to see how much, what is the heating value and so on. So some of these have been again taken from literature. We have shown the papers that we have used for this purpose. And the parameter study, we have looked at the effect of air ratio, steam ratio, particle diameter, and then the output of gas temperature, gas composition, and so on. So you see that, for example, the variation of temperature for different pressures. So what we find is that at lower pressures, the temperature rises relatively low. But as you go to, for example, the curve 5, curve 4, curve 3, curve 2, curve 1, etc. for higher pressures, as you go to higher and higher pressure, the reaction is happening faster. The temperature variation shows that. Temperature builds up very quickly. So what this means is that, why is this happening? Obviously, higher pressure means more oxygen available, so it can penetrate more. So those kind of issues are there. This visually shows the evolution of volatiles. See, something about the numerical modeling is that very often it gives you a very easy way of understanding the phenomena that are happening. So here we see that again at different conditions, different pressures, 20 bar, 10 bar, 5 bar, etc. The evolution of volatile. By the way, evolution of volatile is sort of little delayed by the high pressure. Mm-hmm. The pressure is little low, it will come out easily. But at higher pressure, it is slightly delayed. That's what we see here. That, So this shows how the volatiles are evolved, at how much distance along this and up to what temperature. The CO, the mole fraction similarly. So higher pressure reaction happening earlier. I think main reason, as I said, is that higher concentration of oxygen will help in the gasification process. So it happens at an earlier distance or earlier time, mm-hmm. whereas at lower pressures it happens at a later time. So similarly, hydrogen evolution. So like this, we can study in detail how evolution of hydrogen, evolution of carbon monoxide, etc. is happening with respect to time, temperature, and so on. These are oxygen compounds. Oxygen is consumed after some distance. Mostly, what is happening after this? So, since we are giving only partial amount of oxygen, it gets consumed in a very short region. Beyond that, we have more things like the Bodard reaction, C plus CO2, etc. Those reactions are all very slow. So, if you depend only on the reactions happening due to oxygen, you will find that conversion is very less. You have to depend on all other reactions as well in order to really complete the process. This shows the effect of particle size. So 35 micron, 77 micron, 21 micron, etc. Obviously, as the particle size is smaller, the reactions will take place earlier, less time. Larger the particle size, it has to diffuse more through the diffusion through the particle core will be very slow. So because of this, we find that ours is like a tubular reactor. So in that, it is happening later, at a later distance. That means at a later time. So obviously, the size does play a role with respect to the gasification. And steam addition, again, we have studied. The main thing about steam addition is that it changes the composition, it increases the percentage of hydrogen. So with the steam, we are able to get more hydrogen. But otherwise, in the sense that the calorific value of the output gas will be more. So the other characteristics, the carbon conversion percentage, heating value, coal gas efficiency, etc. at different pressures, we have plotted there. So obviously at higher pressure, there is higher conversion and higher heating value, higher coal gas efficiency. Lower pressure, it is not. So this is to be expected, but the model is able to predict it quite well. And other characteristics, with respect to steam ratio, again, higher steam ratio, results in also, I mean, you will find that there is greater calorific value will be relatively greater at higher steam ratio. So there is some kind of optimal steam ratio, we have to look at that. Okay, this is okay, some temperature variation, etc. So we have looked at comparison between Indian coals and Australian coal. Obviously, Indian coal having more ash, the reactions were definitely slower in case of the Indian coal. You can see the, yeah. In fact, we have had fairly reasonable comparison between the as function of air ratio. The numerical and experimental results are reasonably comparable. Yeah, for different coals. Yeah, coal A, coal B, coal C, these are different grades of coal. Particle size effect, as I mentioned earlier, the larger the particle size, smaller will be the carbon conversion and anything else. So obviously, if you can break it up into smaller size, it will improve the, as I mentioned, the entering bed gasifier is the work that we did about 10 years back with a PhD student. The last 4 or 5 years we've been working on a fluidized bed gasifier, this 100 kilowatt capacity. This was through the FP7 project. And even then, it is still a smaller thing only. It's about 150 mm diameter tube, long tube. This gasifier itself is about 6 meters high. And so with a lot of thermocouples and so on to measure the temperature as a function of height and to collect the ash at the bottom, etc. We have to recover the heat also, so steam generation, again using whatever heat that we get here. So it's a full setup which is there. I would say in an academic institution, 100 kilowatt gasifier itself is difficult to handle. In fact, we have 2 gasifiers. One is a fluidized bed gasifier, other one is actually the circulating bed gasifier. That is still, it needs to be completed. Nearly, I would say 80-90% were done on setting it up. And yeah, so we have done quite a few studies at different power levels, coal feed rate, air flow rate, etc., with and without steam flow. So these experiments show that for different test runs, the particle size, the velocity, fluidization velocity, and so on, and bed height, how it has expanded. And also, with respect to time, how the temperature is changing, how the different gases, their evolution. But what we find is that in a reactor like this, first 2 hours, it's not at steady state. A lot of changes are taking place, it's still settling down. But after 2 hours, more or less, we get data which are steady data available. So we find that the carbon dioxide, carbon monoxide, hydrogen, methane, their concentrations are fairly steady. And the calorific value as a function of air coal ratio, steam coal ratio, etc. With as steam increases, the calorific value does increase in the range of 4 to 5 megawatt per normal meter. That is about what you will get for the low calorific value gasification, as others also did a similar kind of thing. As you increase the air fraction, obviously instead of gasification will be combustion will be happening. So the calorific value of the gas will go down with higher air. So we have to use minimum or optimum air and not more, and preferably use more steam. So coal gas efficiency is the range of about 60%, etc. 60 to 70% you are able to get. Yeah, for different conditions, this shows a summary of the results. So again, just to share our experiences, we have done an entrained bed gasifier at let's say for the capacity of about 20 kilowatts, and a fluidized bed gasifier for a capacity of about 100 kilowatts with Indian coal. And what we find is that parameters like temperature, pressure, particle size, etc., and air ratio, steam ratio, etc., do play a role. And it is possible to optimize the process by varying these. It is also possible, of course, to model. What we find is that with existing data in the literature and whatever else that we could measure experimentally, a reasonable model can be set up within, let's say, which within something like plus minus 5%, we are able to predict the results. But this is, I would say, for processes happening in the gasifier as a react. But underground coal gasification, as I said, is altogether a different entity. But many of these parameters, I'm sure, what we do in the academic institutions will be useful for modeling underground coal gasification itself. And as I mentioned earlier, it is being said that the moving bed or fixed bed reactor, some of those aspects will be similar to UCG. Probably one has to take that to model underground coal gasification. Is there any questions? I'll be more than happy.